As only you can touch all the people that ask for special prayer just today alone, Heavenly Father. Father, we bless, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. Oh, in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. And thank God. We're back again. We are still in the book of Acts. So you may want to open your Bibles to Acts, the 13th chapter. Acts, the Acts of the Apostles. The Acts of the Apostles, praxis in the Greek, the exploits of extraordinarily blessed, Holy Ghost-filled men. The book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 13. We left you on verse 30 last week. If we have to use the subject this week, they beg that these words might be preached to them. Can you imagine that? I've been preaching for 31 years. I've been a layman for over 50 years. And I did not even understand that this was even in the Bible. That's why it's important to study God's word. Study to show thyself approved, a workman that needed not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. A lot of people go to church every week and don't even know it's in the Bible. They get their funk on, their sing on, their praise on. I'm not knocking that. You should get that. But you also need to know what's in the Word of God. So we're in the 13th chapter, and we're beginning with verse 31. But we're going to also gravitate a little bit of what we had last week, the 30th verse. But God raised him from the dead. Who is he talking about? Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He raised him from the dead. It is important, brothers and sisters, that you believe this. I'm running into so many people that do not believe in the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Let's look at verse 31 and 32. He was seen for many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. Verse 32 says that we declare to you glad tidings, that promise which was made by the fathers. He was seen by those people for many days. Now to get that and to gravitate to that and to understand that, you got to look at the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 3, to whom he was also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of these things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Meaning after Jesus was bodily resurrected, people actually cohabitated with him, people actually heard him, people actually saw him. Now, for the proof of that, you got the first one was Mary Magdalene. She actually saw Jesus after the resurrection. Next, there were other women at the tomb. They came, they saw Jesus. Hallelujah. Number three, Peter saw Jesus in Jerusalem. Number four, the two travelers on the road actually saw Jesus. Number five, 10 disciples behind closed doors saw our Lord and Savior. They actually saw our Messiah. Number six, all 11 of the disciples saw Jesus. Hallelujah. Seven, the disciples that were fishing out on the Sea of Galilee saw Jesus. Number eight, 11 disciples on a mountain in Galilee saw Jesus. Hallelujah. Number nine, a crowd of 500 people saw Jesus. Number 10, Jesus' brother James saw him. Number 11, all those who watched him ascend to heaven, they actually saw the ascension. They saw Jesus leave this earth and go to heaven. And number 12, Saul, Shaul, who later on became known as Paul, actually saw Jesus. So there were people who saw Jesus. And the Bible says, back in Acts, the first chapter, 40 people had saw him. So Christ. Verse 33. God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus, as it is also written in the second Psalm. You are my son. Today I have begotten you. So when we look at verse 33, this is taken from, hallelujah, Psalms 2. I will declare and decree, the Lord has said unto me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. The only person that can begotten anything is God Almighty. A lot of people like to say, oh, that's my begotten son. Oh, that's my begotten daughter. Oh, that's my begotten grandchild. No, there's only one, and his name is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Savior. It is Jesus the Messiah. There's only one, and his name is Jesus. Now, this is also a prophecy that was fulfilled. A lot of people today, I know they're into prophecies, and I've addressed that, and I'll address it again. These are real prophecies that came to pass on the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, from Psalm 2:7 to the time Jesus was born. That was another fulfillment of prophecy. Again, when people come to you in all these prophecies, let them come by the Word of God. It has to line up with the Word of God. And they're just saying things to be saying things. The YouTube, the internet, and FaceTime, Facebook are full of people with all these prophecies, but where is it in Scripture? Must line up with Scripture. Amen? Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 33. And we've read verse 33. Verse 34. And that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption. He has spoken. Thus, I will give you the sure mercies of David. Now, I'm going to read another version of that scripture. Verse 34 of Acts 13. As for the fact that he raised him up from the dead, no longer to return to decay. That's the optimum word, decay. Decay. He did not raise him to return to decay. He has spoken in this way, I will give you the holy and sure blessings of David, meaning David, meaning King David. When we say decay, decay, diatharia, diatharia, decay means when you pass away, you decay. Everybody that you know will decay. Everybody that you've ever known has decay. Whether they went and were burned up and that way, or whether they just wasted away, you go into, once you die, you are within hours of decay. I remember many years ago I did a funeral in which the young man had died, and he'd been dead close to a month. I thought they'd bury him because I was in the hospital. The hospital said, no, you got to bury him. And I went there, and poor thing, he was in a state of rapid decay. They couldn't even get the fruit flies out of there. They were, when they lifted that veil, they just swarmed out. And the mortician did everything she could do to keep the flies away, but he was in a rapid state of decay. Another funeral I was at with a young man, they told people not to touch him, how silly people are. Oh, I got to get my last kiss. And one girl blew her mind when she kissed, and he's just like, I'm touching this chalice here. His skin just sunk in. He was in decay. It was the hot sacramental summer, and he had already begun to decay. So when you die, there is decay. When we die, these old fleshly temples in which we live in, there's going to be decay. But the Holy One did not decay. Verse 35. Therefore, he also says in another psalm, you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption. Another part of that verse is, you will not see the Holy One undergo decay. Jesus was the only one that did not undergo decay, because he was our Lord and Savior, and he died, but he came back to life
tabernacled again. He was resurrected again. He tabernacled here. He was ascended onto heaven. He's now sitting on the right-hand side of the Father. Hallelujah. 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 He did not decay. He did not undergo decay. We are going to decay, but our Lord didn't decay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 36, for David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell asleep, meaning he died, was buried with his fathers, and saw corruption, meaning he saw decay. David saw decay. Mighty as David, King David was, as well known as he was, they had the star people to call his name daily with that star of David on. He still decayed. But Jesus did not decay. What people don't understand, this little bit of life that we're here, these little itty bitty short centrifugal, this little bit of time, this little time, it's this time that's fleeting, this time that's passing away. We get so caught up in who and what we are, we don't understand that we're just hours and days away from decay. But hallelujah, when Jesus is your Lord, when Jesus is your Savior, hallelujah, even though you are going to see corruption, hallelujah, you're still going to see him in eternal life. He's your Lord and Savior. Hallelujah. I'm going to say another hallelujah on that. Hallelujah. 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 Verse 37. But he whom God raised up saw no corruption. Jesus never saw corruption. His body never wasted away. The maggots did not eat him away. The fruit flies did not help. The regular flies did not help. The purple plastic, less liquid in your body, even though they embalm you, there's still a certain trace of it in your body, and it'll still stink and cause your body to decay even quicker. When your blood, if your blood doesn't all come out, you're still going to decay. You are in a state of decay, but with Jesus, even when you decay here, then hallelujah, your soul is going to be with him. Hallelujah. That's what we ought to be happy about. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 38. Hallelujah. One more point. One more point before I read 38. Brothers and sisters, there is no reincarnation. Every year, things in the New Age movement prop their heads up. And I've noticed the last 6 or 7 months, a lot of people are saying, well, they're rejecting Christianity. They believe they're going to be reincarnated. Some believe they're going to be reincarnated as an animal. Some believe they're going to be reincarnated as a fellow relative later on down life's road. Some people think they're going to come back as a great person. Some people are even going to come back God-like. No, brothers and sisters, no. When you decay, here, let me give you the best answer. Hebrews, the 9th chapter, verse 27. It is appointed unto men once to die. After this, the judgment. Another version of Hebrews 9:27. We die only once, and then we are judged. That's it. You're only going to do this one time. That's why it hurts when I see people wasting so much time, and life is a beautiful and a precious thing, and instead of living life and enjoying your life and loving your family and loving other people. They waste a whole lot of time tripping. They waste a whole lot of time tripping. They waste a whole lot of time being mean and hateful and figuring out other ways to be nasty and hateful and envious to people. But my brothers and my sisters, this little bit of time in which we have, you ought to try to love one another with all my heart, mind, soul, body, and strength. And the second is to love thy neighbor as thyself, because time is short. Let me finish on and finish up here today. Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sin. This man that he's talking about in verse 38, look at verse 38 again. This man is preached to you the forgiveness of sin. That man is Jesus Christ, verse 39. And by him, everyone who believes is justified from all things, that which you could have not been justified by the law of Moses. That means you can go back to Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, represent Deuteronomy, but the covenant of Jesus supersedes all of that. Verse 40, then beware therefore, lest what has been spoken to the prophets come to you. Verse 41, behold, you despisers, marvel and perish, for I will work a work in your days, a work in which you will be by no means believe, though you were declared it to you. So what he's saying in that verse 41, despite all you despisers, behold all you hateful people, you may not want to believe the message of Jesus, but marvel this, you're going to perish, for I will work in your days a work which you will be by no means believe, though one declare it unto you. That person, no matter who declares it unto you, they're declaring Jesus unto you. They're declaring eternal life to you. They're declaring who Jesus is to you. Today, a lot of people don't want to declare that. They want to believe what they want to believe, but you've got to keep on telling people that Jesus, the never-ending story, the never-ending story is that Jesus died on that cross and rose on the third day morning with all power in his hands. That's a never-ending story. That's a marvelous story. Now here's the end, verse 42. So when the Jews went out to the synagogue, the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. I never noticed that in the Bible. They begged, they wanted to hear more and more of the word of the true and the living God. They begged. They had a yearning for the word of God. They were desiring the word of God. They were thirsty for the word of God. They were parakaleo, which means begging. Parakaleo, give us more of the word of God. They were urgent for the word of God. They also were endowed with the power of the Holy Ghost. My brothers and my sisters, when people leave church today, instead of wanting to yearn to hear more of God's word, they want to go and get in the mischief. They want to go and yip yap at the mouth. But my brothers and sisters, this little bit of short of time that we got to tell somebody about Jesus. I don't know about you, but no matter, even if I preach myself, sometimes I go on and hear a preacher that I know because I'm begging more. I'm begging more for the word of God. I'm more parakaleo. I want to hear more of the word of God. I want to live and exist more in the word of God. I'm happy about the word of God. Tell the people that Jesus is real. People may not want to hear it, but you can still, and you're still endowed with the power of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost will give you power to go forward. Your power, Holy Ghost, will give you power to tell people that don't want to hear what you've got to say, but you keep on telling them about the word of the true and the living God. Keep on telling them about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.